Hello students, my name is Prerna and I'm your EVS teacher. And today from your EVS book Enviro, we are going to be reading chapter number 19. Tell me, are you feeling a little monotonous at home or with your schedule? So I'm going to take you out for a tour. And where? In our country only. So we are going to visit India. What places in India are we going to visit? Let's find out through this chapter. So, this is chapter number 19 and the name of the chapter is Heritage Sites and Buildings. So, we are going to see a lot of monuments. We're going to find a lot about these monuments. So, are we ready? So, let us start with our tour. But first, let us understand a few things, like what is a heritage building? A building which is considered by the government to have historic, cultural, and architectural value is called a heritage building. Heritage is something that gives us a sense of belonging and informs us about how the society was developed. Monuments and buildings are very important for us to learn about the past and our heritage, like who built it, why was it built, even things like what kind of material was used and why a particular kind of material was used, why not anything else, and how did this how did this monument help the ruler at that time. So things like this. Forts, palaces, place of worship and tombs are some of the different types of heritage buildings. Now let us learn about these heritage buildings in our country. All set for your tour? All right, so the first place that you are going to is Agra to watch Taj Mahal. And it is also one of the seven wonders of the world. It is situated along the bank of River Yamuna in Agra. And why was it built? And by whom was it built? It was built by Mughal Emperor Shah Jahan in the memory of his beloved wife, Mumtaz Mahal. Shah Jahan longed for building something unique and unforgettable to commemorate his wife. So he sent for the finest architects and craftsmen from all over the world to build this monument. And there were about 20,000 laborers who worked day and night for 20 years. So it took 20 years to build the beautiful Taj Mahal. And it also has a huge garden all around it and a pool. It is surrounded by a wall of red stones. It is made up of white marble with passages from the Quran inscribed on the outer walls. It is believed that over 40 types of gems were used to decorate Taj Mahal. The Taj Mahal looks marvelous in a full moon light lit night because of its dazzling white beauty. So if you have seen the Taj Mahal, good enough. If you have not seen the Taj Mahal, then I have shown you I've given you maybe a virtual tour of Taj Mahal. And you can also see it on your own. Now you have the Hawa Mahal. It is situated in Rajasthan. So from Agra, from Uttar Pradesh, now we are moving to Rajasthan, where we are going to the Hawa Mahal to enjoy some air, to enjoy some sprinkling, some sparkling air around us. And who built it? Maharaja Sawai Pratap Singh in 1799. It was a five-story structure with many small windows. The royal women of the place could have the view of the outside through these small windows. And it is built of red and pink sandstone. All right. And now we come to Delhi. Where? At the Red Fort. And this was also built by Shah Jahan. It was the residence of Mughal Emperor and was built as a fort so that it could be defended from attacks. It is surrounded by a wall of red sandstone and has a number of gates. Inside the red fort, we find Diwan-e-Aam, where the king could meet the common people, and Diwan-e-Khaas, where he could meet his ministers and advisors. We also find a number of palaces where the emperor and the royal family lived. So now in Delhi, we have seen the red fort. It's time to move to Qutub Minar. It is the tallest tower in India. It is 72.5 meters tall and it's located in New Delhi. Construction of Qutub Minar was started by Qutbuddin Aibak, the first ruler of slave dynasty, and it was completed by his successor and son-in-law, Qutbuddin. It is said that Qutub Minar has 7 stories in all, but at present only 5 are left. The first 3 stories are made of red sandstone. The 4th and the 5th story, they are made of marble and sandstone. Each story is separated from the lower one by a balcony. So if you get a chance to go to, let's say, a second or the third story of Qutub Minar, then how do you see the view on the ground? So there's a balcony, kind of a circular balcony. The tower is wide at the bottom, but it becomes narrow as it goes up like this. So you can have a look at this image as well. Walls of the Minar are inscribed with verses from Quran. Quwwatul Islam Mosque, the first mosque in India, it stands at the base of Qutub Minar. Inside the courtyard of the mosque stands a 7 meters high iron pillar. So you can see this iron pillar. It attracts the archaeologists and scientists from around the world because of its rust-proof property. So imagine this is made up of iron, but it has not rusted in so many years. And the pillar is engraved with inscriptions in Sanskrit and Brahmi script. And I remember when I was in school, so we were taken for a picnic here. And there is also a belief that if you can actually stand against the pillar and, you make a belt with your hands around the pillar, if you're able to make, like, you stand like this and then you make a belt from your hands, like on the back of your side, you are able to clench your hands like this around the pillar, and whatever you wish for, it becomes true. It's just a belief. I mean, it's something that we were told and we heard at that time. So we really don't know because we could not do it. So we could not make a wish as such. But this iron pillar has this unique property that it has not rusted in so many years, right? And you should go and visit this. If you're going to Qutub Minar, you need to visit this iron pillar as well. Then you have Char Minar. Now we've gone to Hyderabad. And it is the marvelous piece of architecture. The beautiful structure got its name from the 4 beautifully carved minarets. These minarets are located at a height of, you can see these minarets. They are located at a height of 46.7 meters above the ground. And it was built with granite and lime mortar. And it looks beautiful when illuminated at night. And now we go to down south, we go to Mysore, where the Mysore Palace is situated. It is also known as Amba Vilas Palace. It used to be the residence of Wodeyar family who ruled over Mysore in 1947. It was built during the 14th century by Wodeyar kings. It was demolished and reconstructed several times. A part of the palace was rebuilt by Krishnaraja Wodeyar IV after the old palace had been destroyed in fire. And the new palace it's a 3-story building. It is made up of grey granite and pink marble. During the Dashara festival, the palace is illuminated and hence looks charming at night, thus attracting a lot of tourists. And now we go to Bombay or Mumbai to see the Gateway of India. It is an arch monument in the shape of an arch. It is an arch monument built during this 20th century in Mumbai, India. Its structure is an arch made of basalt, and it was built on the occasion of the visit of King George V of England and his wife. This monument has also been referred to as Taj Mahal of Mumbai, and is the city's top tourist attraction. And now we go to down south again to Karnataka to visit Gol Gumbaz. Where is it situated? In Karnataka at Bujapur. It is the second largest dome. So you see the structure? This is called as a dome. It is the second largest dome in the world. It is the mausoleum of Muhammad Adil Shah. This huge dome stands without any pillars. It is also called as a whispering gallery because echoes can be heard even if someone nearly whispers. So if you go here, if you go to Gol Gumbaz and you just say something, if you whisper some, let's say something in your friend's ears or in your brother or let's say sister's ears. So whatever you say, even that will echo. So your sound will bounce. All right. And that's why it's called the whispering gallery. Next, we go to Orissa to see the beautiful Konark Sun Temple. And it was built by King Narasimha Deva in the 13th century AD. It is the temple which is devoted to sun god and is built in the form of sun's god chariot with 24 stone wheels. Each of the wheels is nearly 10 feet in diameter. The chariot is drawn by 7 horses. Construction of the temple is such that the first rays of the sun fall on its main entrance. So the moment sun rises, the rays will always fall at the entrance. And it is made up of stone called Kandalith, which gives it a black appearance. It is also known as Black Pagoda. The Konark Sun Temple consists of extraordinary sculptures portraying scenes from civil life and war. And every year, the Konark Dance Festival and Sun Festival are also celebrated here. And now we go to Tamil Nadu to visit the Meenakshi Temple. And it bears its name after it's being dedicated to Goddess Meenakshi and has its complex is one of the largest ones in the world, in India. It was built in the 16th century and has 12 gopurams or towers. And now we go to the northern part of India to visit Golden Temple. All right, so let's go to Golden Temple. All right, so let us find out about the Golden Temple. The Golden Temple is a holy place of Sikhs located in Amritsar in Punjab. It is also known as Harmandir Sahib or Darbar Sahib. It was built during the reign of Akbar, the Mughal emperor who treated all religions with equal respect. So he was secular in nature. The construction of Gurudwara began under the fourth Sikh Guru, Guru Ram Das, and was completed by his successor, Guru Arjun Dev. The foundation stone was laid by a fakir named Mian Mir. The domes of the temple are covered with gold, and that's why it's also called as the Golden Temple. Maharaja Ranjit Singh did the seva of gold plating the temples as well as adding marble to it between 1802 to 1830. Gurbani, it is recited here from dawn till night, and Akal Takht, meaning the throne of God, the highest seat of Sikh religious authority, is situated inside the Golden Temple complex. And there's a sacred tank surrounding the temple in which the pilgrims bathe. And now we go to Aurangabad to see the caves of Ajanta and Ellora. And these are rock-cut caves famous for their sculptures and paintings by Buddhist monks. These sculptures and paintings depict Buddha's life and episodes of Jataka tales. These are estimated to have been built during the period between 2nd century and 6th century BC, right? So these Jataka tales, they basically consist about, they tell you about the life of Gautam Buddha in the form of, in the human form and in various other different forms as well, right? Then the Ellora caves are a few miles away from Ajanta caves. These caves were built by the kings of Rashtrakuta dynasty. These caves are known for their rock-cut temples of Buddhist, Hindu and Jain regions. They are estimated to have been built between 5th century to 10th century BC. So these are the Ajanta caves and these are the Ellora caves. And now we go to the central part or the heart of the country, which is Madhya Pradesh, to see the beautiful Sanchi Stupa. It is a dome-shaped Buddhist shrine believed to contain the remains of Lord Buddha. So see, this is Sanchi Stupa. The Great Stupa, it is the oldest stone structure in India. It was built atop a hill by the Mauryan Emperor Ashoka in 3rd century BC. The Great Stupa was originally a brick structure that was later enlarged with stonework. It has gateways called Karunas with beautiful carvings depicting scenes from the life of Buddha and of course the Jataka tales. And later other kings, they built stupas and temples around the Great Stupas. Around 50 monuments on the hill at Sanchi together are listed as World Heritage Site. Now, we have so many beautiful monuments in India that attracts a lot of tourists and that makes our country so special, right? But it is a little sad to know that some people, they have spoiled these monuments in some way or the other. So that is where the preservation of monuments, the practice of preservation of monuments came into being. Historical monuments are our heritage. The people from different parts of the world and the country come to see these places. They have not only historical but also ecological, social and cultural importance. Being responsible citizens, it is important that we protect them, as you know, these reflect about our culture. So the Archaeological Survey of India, it is a government organization which preserves and protects these natural monuments. It also undertakes the repair and maintenance of these buildings. And this is more of a restoration of these monuments. This act of, you know, probably repairing these and maintaining these monuments, this is restoration of the monuments. So UNESCO has selected some historical monuments as World Heritage Site, like you spoke about the Sanchi Stupa. Some the World Heritage Sites in India, of course, Taj Mahal, Ajanta Ellora Caves, Qutub Minar, and Sun Temple, and here we spoke about the Sanchi Stupa as well, right, which is also a World Heritage Site. So how do we protect these monuments? First is, we should not scratch or write anything on these monuments. We should not even throw garbage around these monuments. We should try to reduce noise as well as air pollution in the area surrounding these monuments. Like a few years back, there was a lot of concern about pollution in Agra, so much that they said that the quality or the color of Taj Mahal was turning from white to a little yellowish. They said that because of pollution, the marble is getting affected. So it is important that these monuments are around these monuments, the environment created is pollution free. And of course, we should purchase entry tickets when we visit them. This money is basically used for maintenance of these monuments. We should not disturb the setting in and around the monuments in any way, and we should follow the law and practice activities that are and not practice those activities which are prohibited in and around these monuments, because we are responsible citizens, right? So it's important for all of you to at least start making your plan, maybe every year. So we've studied about 7 to 8 monuments. So maybe for the next 7 to 8 years, you can plan your vacation accordingly. You can decide which monument is that you would like to visit. So happy traveling and happy learning. Thank you so much.